Very happy morning to all my students. Students, in the previous lecture, we have started with the chapter Measurement and Motion. And today, we are going to pursue with the same chapter. Now, in the previous class, we have done the concept that why measurement is very much important in our daily life. And in this video, our objective will be to describe the various modes of transportation, to explain the standard units of measurement and what does it mean by the standard units, and we will also learn about the types of motion. Now students, in the early timing, people use a number of ways to measure the length. For example, the length of the foot, the distance of the steps, and the width of the hand that was used as a tool to measure the lengths or the distances covered. But there were a number of ways by which it was used, which create confusion. For example, if a person is longer in the length, then his hand span and the width of the hand will be more. If a person is long in the length or he is tall, then he will cover more distance as compared to a person who is short. So to avoid confusion, the scientists, they established an international system of units, that is SI units. In 1960, these units were accepted. And in these units, for length, meter was accepted. For mass, kilogram was used as the SI unit. For temperature, Kelvin was used. For time, seconds. To measure the current or electricity, ampere was used, and to know the amount of substance which is smaller in the amount, moles were used, and similarly, intensity of light was used in candela. So these were some basic SI units. For example, if you know the amount of soft drink, then as it is a liquid, so its volume will be measured and it will be taken in mLs, that is milliliters or liters. If you want to know the bag of potato, then the weight of that bag of potato will be noted and it will be taken in kgs or grams, means kilograms or grams. Same way, length can be measured in meters and temperature can be measured in Kelvins. Now students, the type or the way or the unit to measure the length, that also depends on the object that you are going to measure. For example, if you want to measure the small objects, then centimeters or millimeters can be used. But if you want to measure the longer distances, you can use kilometers. Kilometers might be mostly used for longer distances. Like New York to Los Angeles, the total distance is 4,501 kilometers. So for measuring any length or measuring the length of any object, we need to choose an appropriate device so as to get the accurate results. For example, the measuring scale that a carpenter uses is different than the one that is used by a tailor. You can look at the picture. In this, the tailor uses a meter scale which is foldable. Now, if both of these, they just exchange the way or exchange the equipment that they use to measure the scale, measure the length, then a huge amount of confusion will be created. Now, This can be more accurately understood by taking this example that if you want to measure the length of a curved line, will you use this type of meter scale? No. So how will you just know its measure, or how will you just measure its length? Firstly, you have to tie a thread along the length of the curve. Then you need to stretch the thread and you need to measure it on the scale. This will give you the exact measure of the length of the thread. Okay, students. So this is the way how we used to measure the length of a curved line. Now, the next part of the chapter is motion. So to start with the chapter, firstly, you should know that what is motion. For this, look at this picture. The honeybee, it is moving or it is flying from one flower to another flower. The blades of the fan are moving when the electricity is applied. So both of these are the examples of the motion. So from here, you can have the definition of the motion, that it is defined as a change in position of an object with time. Okay, students. So whenever an object, it changes its position with respect to time or with respect to some other object standing over there, then we say that the object is in motion. Now, there are a number of types of motion. First is vibratory motion. In vibratory motion, the object moves to and fro about a fixed position. Okay, students. Then we have the linear motion. There are two types of linear motion. One is this type of motion in which the object moves in the straight line. Then the other type of linear motion is curvy linear motion, in which the object moves straight but he or she covers a distance which is in a curve. Then we have oscillatory motion, where the object moves to and fro about a mean position. Such a motion is known as oscillatory motion. Next is circular motion, in which an object moves in a circle. Then we have rotatory motion. In rotatory motion, the object rotates continuously. Okay, students. So in this way, we have a number of types of motion. Now, we have two more types of motions, that are periodic and non-periodic. Students, periodic motions are the motions which repeats themselves after a regular interval of time. A fair example of this is movement of Earth. Earth revolves around the sun, and it took about 365 days to complete its one revolution. Then after that, again Earth starts with the same. Or the another example for this is the movement of needles of a clock. That is also periodic motion. It covers equal distance in equal interval of time and repeats itself also. The another type of motion is non-periodic motion. Now, in the case of non-periodic motion, the body repeats itself, but not in the fixed interval of time. A very good example of this is the motion of a vehicle. A vehicle can move very fast also, and it has to apply brakes also when there is red light or a traffic is there. So in this way, there is fair difference between periodic and non-periodic motion. Now, students, there is one more type of motion in which number of motions are combined. Such a motion is known as multiple motion. Here I have taken the example of a bicycle. The rider moves the bicycle in this straight motion, which is known as translational motion or rectilinear motion. But if you look at the wheels of the bicycle, they are moving in rotational motion. So in this way, both translational and rotational motions are combined together in order to move the bicycle. So such a motion in which more than one motion is combined is known as multiple motion. Okay, students? So this finishes with the chapter. I hope you have understood with the concept. If you have any kind of confusion, feel free to call. Thank you. Have a nice day.